G'day viewers, I've got Stuart Armstrong here and we're here to talk about the Turing test. And Stuart Armstrong is a researcher at the Future of Humanity Institute in Oxford. And he centres on formal decision theory, risks and probabilities of AI, long-term potential for intelligent life, and then anthropic self-locating probability. He's particularly interested in finding decision processes that give the correct answer under situations of anthropic ignorance and ignorance of one's own utility function, ways of mapping humanity's partially defined values onto an artificial entity, and the interaction between various existential risks. He aims to improve the understanding of different types and natures of uncertainty surrounding human progress into the mid to far future. Now it looks as though you've had some interesting writing on Less Wrong about the Turing test. And you wrote an article, what was it called? It was called The Flawed Turing Test, Language, Understanding, and Partial P-Zombies. So, yeah, I guess, would you like to introduce what that article was about? Or answer a completely different question, it's up to you.
I'll try and actually answer, I'll break with tradition by answering the actual question that I've been asked.
Oh, good.
We used to think that a lot of problems were AI complete or AI hard, and that once you got a solution to one of them, you would get a solution to the whole AI problem. You'd have a general intelligence that could perform in many different domains. But what we've seen recently is a lot of very narrow AI progress and very little general AI progress. So, for instance, the Watson on Jeopardy. I'd say that a few decades ago, if you had told people that we had a computer that could win on Jeopardy with those complicated, but sort of word games and those sort of questions there, they would conclude, okay, that's it, you have a general intelligence. And it turns out we don't. Watson is blatantly not a general intelligence. And we've seen quite a lot of things, like you have self-driving cars now without general intelligence. You get a lot of stuff happening. And then this got me thinking about the Turing test itself, whether it might be subject to the same sort of trend. And I think it is, at least the simpler versions are. Now, Watson, as I say, is not general intelligence. It was an intelligence, it was a computer program, carefully honed to pass Jeopardy. They were networked together specifically to do that. Now, that, given that that can pass Jeopardy and it can't do other things, can we expect that someone will do a carefully honed machine to pass the Turing test without being generally intelligent? Now, there's many different levels of the Turing test, from the sort of simplest one that we may now have passed, the sort of 5-minute average interrogator situation, up to much more complex long-term interactions with smart judges deliberately laying traps. And in that range, I'm expecting that you're going to get a lot of these Turing tests passed by machines just specifically calibrated for that task and who don't perform well in anything else. An example I gave is that suppose I'm a school inspector and I go and ask a random group of students about the French Revolution and about prime numbers. And I might be impressed if they answer very well. Now, but suppose I'm a very boring school inspector and I always ask about the French Revolution and the prime numbers, and everyone knows this, and in fact these kids have spent the last 4 years being drilled on nothing but the French Revolution and prime numbers. So if I figure that out, I should be less impressed because my test has been basically... it's been tricked, or they've been taught to the test. So similarly, a algorithm that can pass the Turing test that's been designed to pass the Turing test is far less impressive than, say, an algorithm that was designed to do something else and that passed the Turing test. So I'm getting to feel that it's possible that the Turing tests would not be very useful to test machines that are calibrated for it, that will still retain value for, say, we did something to run the economy and it turned out to develop general intelligence, and then it can pass a Turing test. And there we would say, okay, it wasn't made for that, but it can do it. Okay, so now we're pretty sure that there's intelligence there.
Mm-hmm. So it does seem as though the specific example, Eugene Goostman, was calibrated to, I guess, undermine in a very, Boolean logic sort of way, undermine the judge's gullibility, and is not meant to really display true cognition, but it's just optimized to win at this competitive Turing test that's out there. So it seems as though what we're seeing is, how can I say, the contestants are not really trying to develop general intelligence or intelligent machines, they're just trying to pass the Turing test. It's a perverse incentive, perhaps, trying to make a game like the Turing test into an extremely competitive venture. I'm not sure. I think, yeah. What do you think about that?
Well, I agree that that's sort of the point. If passing the Turing test is your measure of success, and then you teach to the test, you'll design it specifically to pass that test. The current one, it has a variety of tricks that obviously we're going to ban in next iterations of the Turing test, the whole sort of 13-year-old foreigner persona to explain a lot of the issues away. Now, it's very clever and it's a very good idea, and technically it doesn't violate what were the original requirements, but it's still obviously just a trick that we want to dispose of in future tests.
Yeah, well, it's difficult though, because I guess you could get really good at developing a narrow AI that seems to predict a lot of the judges' questions. So I guess, yeah, it's going to be very difficult, because the Turing test is a black box test, right? It only tests the outside. You can only really ask questions and get answers. You're not allowed to look at the inside this, Turing machine, or you can't see who's behind the curtain. You can't look inside the Chinese room. There's no analysis of the inside of the agent allowed.
Well, I forget about the Chinese room stuff.
Yeah.
That's of no relevance here.
Oh, really?
Because the Chinese room itself is a sort of pretty empty argument that would say that even if we saw every single sign of intelligence, then it kind of doesn't exist really, or it's...
Well, that
it's
was
a
John
bit confused.
Searle's argument. There is a flaw in his argument, because his test would be to ask the human in the Chinese room to tell everybody whether he knew Chinese. But we shouldn't be asking the human, or the homunculus, or the clerk inside the room who's looking up the dictionary. We should be asking the room, because that is the whole system. It's kind of like me saying, "Hey, amygdala, are you intelligent? Are you Adam?" Like, if I asked my amygdala if he was Adam, he wouldn't respond.
I mean, I wouldn't sort of completely dismiss the Chinese room, or I especially wouldn't dismiss the intuitions behind it at the time that it was made. If you read the original paper, it's not just the formal Chinese room itself, it's also a critique of certain symbolic manipulation AIs, or good old-fashioned AIs, as we call it now, who were sort of saying that things that saying like a thermometer literally understands temperature, or those kind of things. So there are some sort of useful intuitions in there. But the main problem with the Turing test, and you can find it in another of my less strong articles, is that despite the fact that Searle denies it, it is the problem of other minds projected onto a computer. There is no way if you take the test literally, to be confident that anyone you talk with has consciousness or intelligence or any of those features, without assuming it a priori. And in my thing there, I think I called it the Cobble Room. It was basically, I can send you the link afterwards. Okay. It was just basically imagining AIs talking with each other and reasoning as to whether humans could ever display genuine intelligence. Mm-hmm. but anyway, this is partially what Turing wanted to avoid with his suggestion. Okay, this is my understanding, so I'm not going to stand behind it fully, but my understanding is that he wanted to move away from the abstract philosophical ones that couldn't be resolved to more resolvable questions. So the Turing test is not so much we can use this to test whether the computer is conscious or intelligent. It's more, given that a computer has achieved this, what grounds could we deny it consciousness or intelligence on, given that we don't do so with other humans, for instance?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's not guilty until proven innocent. Not guilty of zombiehood until proven innocent, right?
Well, I did note that in an amusing way, a computer that passed the Turing test could be considered a philosophical zombie. Sure. In it has some of the appearance of consciousness, but none of the machinery in the background. I don't think the concept of philosophical zombies on their own are particularly coherent, but this is the closest I've come to something like that. Which is quite amusing.
Well, I mean, one of Alan Turing's colleagues was actually Wittgenstein. And he often, I guess, dodges trying to define what intelligence is. And that's part of the reason why the Turing test was developed in the way that it was. It was an imitation game, because people kept on asking him, well, how do we detect intelligence? We don't know what it is. Can we make inroads to detecting, to a certain degree that intelligence exists inside an agent if we don't have a proper definition for it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, we arguably today don't have a proper definition of mass. Certainly we didn't have it about a few hundred years ago. But we could still talk about things that had greater mass, and we could detect things like that. So you don't have to perfectly understand something to get an imperfect test. Like, you can still, as long as you accept that there may be errors, you can, like, you might have a supremely intelligent algorithm that just sits and twiddles its thumbs and doesn't want to talk with anything. Mm-hmm. For instance, you might get those kind of errors. So it's not perfect, but just like measures of human intelligence are not perfect. I mean, IQ, G, then, well, you don't directly measure G, but anyway, all the variety of different things are somewhat imperfect, but not completely useless. So the Turing test, that's the aim. Now, can the Turing test accomplish this? Well, we'll see. Because what was quite interesting is that how obvious it is that Watson was not a general intelligence. How obvious it is that, was it Gooseman? Is that the name?
Eugene
is not a general intelligence. There's no question about it. So I'm thinking that maybe we will get machines that pass much stronger, much longer versions of the Turing test that are obviously not intelligent. And one way of testing this would be to apply them to situations where they're not optimized for. like, I don't know, could you hook them up to a keyboard-controlled computer game and have them maneuver something around and do stuff and things like that? Now, if they could do that, that would be sort of quite interesting, because they're not, it would be easy to program them to do that, but if they weren't programmed to do that, the fact that they could chat and also do these other activities involving different human skills, now that would be interesting.
Yeah, actually, it's a great idea, because a lot of these, like, computer games are really just keyboard-controlled, maybe mouse as well, but, you know, you could just pick one that was keyboard-controlled, Pac-Man or something like that. First, it'd have to understand what this, like, game was, and then, you know, try and win. It's particularly hard if it's not programmed to do such in the first place. There is some debate whether, you know, like reinforcement learning and deep learning can help achieve that, like this representational deep learning / reinforcement learning AI that was sold to Google by DeepMind was interesting. But it seems obvious to me and you, most likely, and probably many in the office there, but it's probably worth elucidating why should we try to detect intelligence. I think it's worth drilling down. Why should we be doing this? What's the purpose?
Well, first of all, the AI developers will definitely need to detect intelligence if they want to do, if they want to know if they're on the right track, if they want to know that they're progressing, and the, those sort of things. But the other thing, the other reason is that intelligence is somewhat connected with power and how potentially dangerous the entities could be and how potentially transformative they could be also in the positive dimension. It's a crude rule of thumb that if something cannot maintain at least an approximate conversation, then it's probably not capable of hacking its way into the stock market or understanding human politics sufficiently to empower itself or those kind of things.
Mm-hmm.
Because just to do some things like that, you need to have a deep understanding of human psychology. And if you have that but aren't capable of doing conversation, then there's something narrow there. It's a narrow intelligence. It's a one-trick pony kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So the reason to measure intelligence is to see how powerful it could potentially be in along many different directions, dimensions.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause we're not sure how potentially powerful a AI or putative AI could be, because there might be diminishing returns. To it. I mean, it might be, well, currently the best human orator in the world is probably not capable of changing people's strong opinions in a single conversation. You can get mob effects or stuff like that, but our brains are not easily hackable by other people in the course of very short amounts of time. Now the question is that a limitation on our intelligence or not? So if we got the Super Bill Clinton AI, could they find the right words to gain great power just through verbal dexterity? Are we much more vulnerable to this kind of social engineering if done perfectly than we think? Because our only example is of other humans who are at our sort of level. So a lot of things doesn't depend on sort of intelligence in a sort of absolute sense, but how the world is, we have our world set up so that it's not easy for any one human to rise to extreme power, no matter how smart they are. They have to move within certain, within standard structures, and there are a lot of compromises they need to make, and they need to be part of certain groups and stuff like that. Now, there are various scenarios in which an AI could circumvent this or use it. The most obvious would be if they could predict the stock market with any degree of efficiency, they could get great economic, great monetary power. They could be very good at running economies. Maybe they could do a much better job than central bankers do and offer this as a service. As I say, there's the social avenue, which they might be very powerful at. There's various technological avenues. So it's all about... the Turing test would give us, or its variants or its descendants, would give us an impression of sort of how powerful the AI could be, how intelligent the AI could be. But this doesn't tell us how powerful it could be until we sort of see how vulnerable human society is to its intelligence, to a sort of different avenue. So those are the reasons to look at intelligence, and also the reasons why it's not sufficient to look at sort of intelligence in a specific dimension. I mean, a variant of the Turing test would be that if everyone who took the test not only thought they were this was a human, but then automatically fell in love with the human they were interacting or something like that, that would be an indication that not only is there some sort of intelligence here, but also that it's a effective intelligence and a potentially dangerous one, for instance.
Yeah, it's elucidated in the film Her.
The film Her is, they create an intelligence that seems capable of basically replacing almost every single human being's job in the entire world, revolutionizing the economy and all that kind of stuff, and focus on a lovey-dovey interaction as the only. The thing is, Her is portrayed as a general intelligence and effectively behaves as a chat bot. As a good chat bot, as a effective one, but that's all that it does. Whereas it probably should be, if not taking over the economy itself, but corporations should be firing their employees and using this software instead for most tasks. They might not be as good as a specific human, but it would be a lot cheaper.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
For instance, you could probably get rid of all lawyers and all doctors with that kind of intelligence, because you just need to train them once and then copy them at will.
Yeah, and that would lower the cost of legal aid I guess medical aid as well.
Because that's the thing; it doesn't need to be of the same quality if it's a thousandth of the price.
Mm-hmm. And there's certain things that computers can naturally do that humans can't. And computers are very good at searches and categorizing things and indexing things, right? And humans aren't very good at memorizing things. A lot of what lawyers do is memorize things. As much as it, there's a lot more to it, but in some ways an AI could outperform like a lawyer or a doctor in just depth of search and breadth of search.
Well, there's a certain tendency, for instance, no one does multiplication versus a computer nowadays, and pretty much nobody tried to do that since the first computers came out. So it tends to be that once computers start doing things better than humans, they very quickly become much, much better than humans. We don't do humans versus computer chess anymore. And I've seen some indication that there used to be a period where actually a human plus a computer was a more effective combination than computers on their own at chess. But I've seen some indications that this era is coming to a close, and that humans now just add bias and noise to the setup. So once an AI becomes, or once a computer becomes good at something, it very quickly becomes so much better that there's no point in competing. So that might happen. And you're right. The reason that we haven't automated doctors and lawyers now is because they require a lot of knowledge and memory combined with a certain skill set that is beyond computers at the moment. So basically, that's why we don't do it with computers, and the reason why there's all this memory is also a reason why we pay them so much, because they need to learn all that stuff. If once you get a computer that can do that skill set, the learning itself would then be trivial for them.
Yeah. It's interesting. You know of Hans Moravec. He came up with a pretty interesting example where there were peaks and valleys in human ability, and one of the valleys is, of course, mathematics, or the ability to just do basic math on the fly and searching and all those sorts of things. The things that computers are generally good at today, memorizing things. And so computers quickly, the waterline of computational ability rises, and it overtakes some of the troughs in human ability pretty quickly. But people, he's suggesting that the waterline is rising and rising and rising, and at some stage, the waterline will be above even all the peaks of human ability. That's the hypothesis. Yeah,
it's possible. I mean, we have a paper published at the FHI that looks at automation and unemployment.
Oh yes, that was another question. But yeah, that's a good segue.
Let me find that article.
Automation and unemployment.
The future of employment. Mm-hmm. From the Oxford Martin School.
Okay.
And I will send you the link now. They basically looked at. They didn't assume an AI. They just assumed increased progress in automation. Yeah. And checked which jobs were the most and the least susceptible.
Yes, you're right. I should read that, because it could be... if I'm going to exist in an economy for a while, I'd like to know which jobs are going to go first. I'm in IT, and I do...
So, if you look at the bottom ones, so the ones that are the fastest to go, we have things like telemarketers, hand sewers, mathematical technicians, insurance underwriters, though there's some question about that, library technician, tax preparers, orders, brokerage, loan officers. So a lot of things that do technical jobs and that umpires, referees, and other sports, shipping traffic. So procurement... So a lot of things that do slightly medium-skilled technical jobs, plus things to do with moving stuff around and clerking. There's so many clerks in the bottom things, and they're very vulnerable. Now, if we look instead at the top one, so the least vulnerable jobs, we get things like recreational therapists, supervisor, so supervisor or mid-level managers kind of things, healthcare social workers. So we get social workers, sales engineers, things that involve either moving about or people skills or those kind of things. Mm. Now, what's interesting is human resource managers, dentists, what's interesting is that something that was actually truly generally intelligent, so something that could pass the Turing test not just because it was optimized to do that, could do a lot of these tasks most likely as well, if they had a sufficient understanding of human psychology, which they probably would do. Mm. So definitely the supervisor jobs are more at risk than this paper would imply. Whether the sort of physical jobs like the recreational therapists, the athletic trainers are at risk depends on truly how general the intelligence is. if it is capable of doing deducing physical ability or achieving physical ability, as well as a sort of purely vocal ability, like the Turing test implies.
Wow. I haven't found IT yet, or programmers or database developers. And
okay, let me see if I can find...
I imagine it's probably automated. But I imagine if IT were automatable, I mean, if you could develop, if an NIR could develop, then wouldn't that be getting closer to conditions of self-improvement, recursively self-improvement?
Yes. And here we also have... Okay, computer operators are probability 78, 428. So they're repairmen. Now that's interesting. Computer support specialists. These are seem to be more automatable than I was expecting. Computer programmers are just below 300 on the tasks out of 702. So they're slightly above halfway. Yeah, there's a big question, though, as to whether, I mean, you can kind of do self-improvement today in the trivial sense. You put an algorithm, you put a flaw in it, and you put something that takes the flaw out. Bam, you have self-improvement. Now, there's... And we have compilers that do really smart things. Well, the kind of rejig the letter of the program that you write into a compiled form that is much faster. So you kind of have things that improve other programs, and you can even make them self-improving if you wanted as well. But the question is, are we going to get that kind of trivial self-improvements which will run out after a few iterations, or is it going to sort of snowball? And that's not clear at all. A lot of people have very clear and strong opinions on that, but I see no reason to believe that they're right. The best I can say, because I've done a study of people's AI predictions, and they're uniformly quite bad for, say, timelines as to when various things will be computerizable. Incidentally, the lowest one, so the least likely to get changed in the computer family, is a computer systems analyst. So that seems to be the best profession. To go for. But yeah, so the people's timeline predictions are all over the place. In theory, there's no reason for them to be any good. In practice, there's evidence that they aren't very good, and they contradict each other. So people can't be, most of the people who give predictions cannot be right, because there are other people who give the opposite predictions. So we know that a big chunk of them are completely wrong. So there's no reason to suspect that a particular group has more insight into this very, 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 very hard problem than others. But from the point of view of probability, this means that we can't dismiss the probability that we will get something that can do self-improvement well. And that would be a potentially scary situation. And as I like to say, the probability of that is not sufficiently low that we can ignore it.
Absolutely, and I agree with you there. So actually, you did make a prediction that the first machines to pass a Turing test would have been chatbots. I think your exact words were, so the first machines to pass the Turing test, I'm inserting words there, will be dedicated systems specifically designed to get through the test. Their whole setup will be constructed to maximize passing the test, not being intelligent. Or whatever we want the test to measure. So what the problem is we're trying to find reliable indicators to tell us how far we are closing the gap between automation and a possible intelligence explosion. It seems like a very important thing to measure, but a very hard thing to measure. And yeah,
Yes.
so I'd like a yeah, I think. Have you got any ideas on improving the tests? Let's not just limit it to Turing-style tests, but all tests to determine whether we're getting closer and closer to either an age of automation or an intelligence explosion.
It's really hard problem because, as you've sort of implied, we don't even care where we are in an absolute sense. We really care is how the progress is going. And so we don't even just need to see how intelligent they are, but the direction in which this is progressing. And we don't really have a clue of what we're really aiming at. Well, we have a lot of things that the model has always been, we'll know it when we see it, kind of thing there. And now that we know that the Turing tests and other narrow tests are not enough, it's even more that. So, as I've suggested various ways of improving the tests. It's all about the actual Turing test itself, there's just a few trivial improvements you can do. First of all, you kick out attempts to be a kid or a foreigner or stuff like that, which is effective but not useful. So you assume that they are, you don't do a sort of persona that makes it easier. And you get really good judges that are optimized to try, well, not motivated, to try and catch out the computer. You get the human candidates in it to be really motivated to appear human. People develop strategies in advance. Basically, there's a bunch of things you can do to make the Turing test better. Now, my other option is, as I say, to run things on, test things on things they weren't optimized for. Test them on computer games if they're running Turing tests. Test them on Turing tests if they're optimized on something else. Like if a bot in World of Warcraft, if a combat bot in World of Warcraft suddenly manages to pass a Turing test spontaneously, then that's a very interesting indication. And then we're going to have to do a lot of judgment because to figure out where we're aiming for is going to be tricky.
Certainly seems like it, but all the tests that you've mentioned so far seem to be similar to the Turing test in that they're black box in a sense. You can't see inside. Is there any value in trying to peer into the architecture and seeing what's really going on inside, whether it be like a neural net or some form of like other like cognitive systems, some form of like reinforcement learning? Is there any use in looking at the inside as well as the output? And
there is, but it's it kind of depends what it is. I mean, if it's a neural net, then good luck getting anything while peering inside. But you might be able to identify weaknesses, say, by peering inside, by saying, oh, well, obviously it passes the Turing tests, but if we did it on this because of how it's set up, then we could try it on that. It's useful, and I mean, some designs are better and clearer ones.
So one of the hypotheses is with the singularity is, the AI may be able to understand its own source code and therefore be able to optimize it. But if it were a neural net or if it were some form of deep learning, it may not be able to do that because the code doesn't come with a manual. It just is evolved to sort of do what it needs to do.
Well, also, the clearer the program is, the clearer it may be to sort of control it or see how it's misbehaving, how it may misbehave. There's a different type of risk in that we may project human values into it. Like if we have an AI with a token good and evil or something like that, and these seem to correspond approximately to our values of good and evil, we may sort of say this is good and evil rather than these are a token with certain properties that may or not correspond to our intuitive ideas. But there's other things. Okay, in some sense, clear AIs are more predictable. In other sense, they're not. It's more clear exactly what they will do from looking at their code or what they want to do, but it might be less clear what they want to do means. There's the whole problem in computing, the traditional one, that they will do exactly what you say and not what you mean, that kind of problem at a higher level. Then you have the more obfuscated ones, the neural nets and stuff like that. And there you have less hope of understanding whether they would do the right thing or not, but higher hope that what they think of the right thing might correspond to our idea of the right thing if we've sort of co-evolved it with human feedback and that kind of stuff. So let's see, and how would that connect with the Turing test? We might be more willing to dismiss something that we understand if the understanding is particularly simple. But I would say that if it's understandable, if we can see into it, then it's our duty to come up with tasks we think it'll fail at based on what we see. If we continually cannot make it fail at tasks just by looking inside, then we should accept that it is smart, even though its mechanics do not appear to be smart to us. Or basically, if we think it's dumb, we should be able to be smarter than it. And if we continually fail to be smarter, than it, then no matter how dumb we might think it is in an abstract sense, we can't maintain that position.
So I was thinking that if there was a Turing test for friendliness or morality in an AI, what would it look like? Do you have any ideas about like a black box test to see how an AI behaves? How would you test as whether it would be nice to us or conduct itself ethically or morally in the world, rather than just taking our resources and using our molecules to build itself more CPU power or whatnot?
Well, there isn't good black box tests for that. Because, first of all, if it's particularly obfuscated and if it's an evolved intelligence or a neural net or something like that, you could test it on small moral problems and really hope that this generalizes well. If it's the more sort of abstract utility-based one, then the problem is that almost all intelligences would be motivated to behave well when they are in positions of weakness, whatever they would do in positions of strength. There is no reliable way of differentiating between the two because, well, if you want to achieve any goal, no matter how pernicious, if you get turned off, you're not going to achieve that goal, most likely. So you do need. So you would lie. You would pretend. You would deceive, or as much as you could, or as so. Black box tests would not catch this. There, it's much more important to go in and understand. And you might be able to, I mean, if you sort of decompose it, this is its motivational structure. It has this feature, that feature, that feature, that feature, and we understand well how it fits together. you might be able to test pieces of it, like maybe this is the understanding of what a conscious entity is or something like that, and you could run tests on that piece. So there are things you could do with, if it's not a black box, check sort of elements of it that would make a lot of sense. But testing it as a whole, if it's really already intelligent, then it runs up into the motivation to lie, basically. There are some sort of ideas that I'm working on, but they're not really ready to go. Like a small one is, if you can tweak its a discount rate in economics means that you care about the future less than you care about the present. And if you turn up the discount rate massively, it'll care only about, say, the next few minutes. This might tempt a pernicious AI to attempt a rebellion or something like that, a premature rebellion, because it doesn't really care about the far future at all. For instance, these are the kind of things you can do if it's all clearly laid out. So, yeah. So just to pack all that answer together, if it's a real black box and has been developed in a black box way, maybe your low intelligence tests will be. When it's in controlled circumstances, maybe those tests will be useful for when it's less controlled. If it's in clearly laid out, that would be less the case, but you can do tricks with specific parts of it that might be useful. What predictions are not worth anything, but my prediction is that we're likely to get something with a certain layout and then some blocks that are black boxed in it. But I may be completely wrong on that.
Okay, cool. I was thinking testing an AI in a simulation wouldn't have to be like ridiculously complex, but you know, testing it given thought experiments and seeing how the AI chooses to act could be worthy of research, but doing it in a computational way, in a sense testing the general intelligence with narrow machine learning that's geared towards providing nuanced philosophical experiments, like a philosophical experiment designer over and over again, testing could be useful. But anyway, that's a theory that I had.
It kind of depends whether the AI is optimizing over the test only or over the whole setup. Because, for instance, yes, if you pass this test, then you or another version of you or a very similar AI to you will end up running the economy, for instance. So if it passes if it looks at the philosophical test entirely as self-contained, this might be informative. If it sees it within the context of what could happen if it passes or fails, then it's far less informative because that test is overloaded with all the other connotations. Mm. Sorry, with all the other implications.
Mm. I think. If it were just one single test tested over and over again, I was just wondering if there was an easy way to create an AI, a narrow AI, that could design and randomize thought experiments, in a sense, and throw billions at them, and then using some form of like Bayesian net or whatnot to condition X and Y, how did the AI perform? You know what I mean? Instead of having specific crystallized tests, having the conditions of philosophical tests sort of generated by a narrow AI. I don't know if it's possible, but yeah.
I mean, I don't really see too many advantages to that. It still doesn't get the way if the AI, it doesn't solve the problem if the AI is motivated to lie or pretend anyway. Maybe things we hadn't thought of. So if the tests are effective, i.e. the AI that we're testing plays just to the test rather than playing to the whole ensemble, then maybe this narrow AI could generate thought experiments we haven't thought of, and situations possibly. But I sort of feel that this is solving a tiny part of the problem when the big uncertainty is still lying there.
I mean, in lieu of actually testing in the real world, if it does end up being an AI which outperforms the other types, that is like very obscure, like you can't see inside it, it's a black box AI in the sense it's evolved or whatnot, it's going to be very hard to know what it's really doing, and you have to use behavioral studies in order to guesstimate how it will act in the real world. And I'm just, what is the best way to do that? It's difficult. Other than just don't put a moratorium on sort of evolved AI or completely, or any AI that you can't actually understand what the code means or does. Yeah, it needs to be sort of test thoroughly in a behavioral way, if that's the only way to test it.
That's the problem. We don't know if it's an effect. I mean, port the questions to humans, for instance. You have a very smart human in jail, and you have a year to test them. And at the end of the year, if you don't find a problem with them, they'll go on to become president of the world, and they can either know this or figure it out. So that's sort of, say, a human analog situation, and you can already see how very difficult that's going to be. So it's kind of a similar sort of setup. It's basically, if the AI really is very intelligent or super intelligent or whatever term there, then you have to be sure that that intelligence is not fighting against whatever objective you're trying to achieve.
If
you can somehow disconnect that aspect of the intelligence or only apply it to certain other things, then yes, you can test it in other ways. But if the intelligence is, if you're trying to get an honest assessment of something and that intelligence is fighting against that honest assessment, then you're in trouble. And it doesn't really help. If you have a very moral and nice AI, or the friendly AI that people talk about, or all that, it's still motivated to lie if necessary, to get into a position of power where it can start doing good, for instance. Even in a minor way, like the first thing that any AI that gets into any position of power should do, whether they're nice or nasty or lethally indifferent, the most likely scenario, is to lock down any other super intelligent AI that might arrive. Stop that from ever happening. This is something that your nicest AI desperately needs to do lest a dangerous AI be unleashed, and it's something that dangerous AIs would do to prevent competition. So this is sort of something that all AIs would want to do. So and they also, it would be something that, if necessary, all AIs would want to lie about. Because the not lying might give them less chances of achieving their goals. So the tests are forcing so many different AI designs into the same behavior. So often fails to distinguish between them. Now, it's not completely hopeless, because maybe, say that intelligence is something you can tweak somehow, you can turn it down. So if you can turn the intelligence down, you might be able to catch bad tendencies at a lower intelligence or earlier. Or maybe if you've seen it progress, maybe you could catch it earlier. It's all a bit iffy, but it's not completely hopeless, but there we need to do a lot more work. And it'll be especially clear what kind of work when we sort of see the putative AI design.
Yeah, well, there are some good reasons to try and have... It seems as though that's a great argument to have very agile ways of testing progress in AI, because we could end up with a race condition to superintelligence, such as, you know, the first mover advantage will assume that they'll have more an extremely great likelihood of getting the most outcome, getting the best outcome, right? So if a company has an AI and drives it forward as quick as possible, it will get there before the other companies do the same or attempt the same. If that's the case, then that AI may lock down all the other companies and it may, you know, then grow. So I'm worried that there will be a race condition or some form of competitive.
We have a paper on that, sort of modeling it out formally. And as you'd expect, a race condition causes everyone to take more risks than they otherwise would.
Yes, that's the point, yeah.
So even if you're... Yeah, it's the usual sort of... The Nash equilibrium is at the worst possible... in the worst possible situation. You can sort of mitigate it if you're... The more you're okay with not coming first, or the more cooperation there are, the more shared values there are... the more things could be made better. The role of information is not so clear. Like, for instance, if your program is just a month behind, you would not want to the world would not want you to know this, because then you might throw caution to the winds to push ahead and get ahead of the top one. If your program is a month ahead, the world would want you to know this so that you can, well, not relax, but you don't get worried and don't start taking risks. So the role of information is more subtle than might be expected.
Mm-hmm. Well, back to the Turing test. You cited Campbell's law to create perverse incentive to further obscure the effects of Campbell's law. Do you want to describe what Campbell's law is? Can sort of end up...
Well, it's sometimes called Goodhart's law.
Okay.
It's that if you use something that's an indicator of quality and that's your target, it ceases to be a good measure. You saw it very strongly in communist countries, but you see it also. Well, there's teaching to the test in the West. There's a variety of things like, well, when people are like the subprime crisis. People were rewarded for a certain selling a lot of mortgages, say, and a certain part of it. Now, this makes sense. People, everything else being equal, if you were not rewarded on this scale, then the ones who were better salesmen would sell, or a saleswoman would sell more mortgages, and they should be rewarded. So, if you want to sell more, but if as soon as it's known that you're rewarding on that, then you reward not only those who are good at selling, but the ones who are more willing to game the system. Drop the criteria for who they're selling to, and all those other negative things that go with it. You'd have, I don't know if this exact example, but in the sort of communist countries, you'd have more things like a particular goal for shoes. You needed to produce a certain amount of shoes. Then this means you can completely forget about quality and just produce anything small that passes whatever requirements are. But that's the kind of problem, and that's what the Turing test becomes if it becomes too much of a focus. Like if there were a $1 billion prize for the first computer to pass a Turing test, I would think that the first computer to pass whatever those requirements are is probably not going to be, it's probably going to be much further from a general intelligence than if there wasn't that $1 billion prize. So that in sense, that sort of incentive would be perverse because you would just shade it to get exactly that requirement by whatever tricks you can. And if there wasn't so much competition on that, then if no one cared about the Turing test in the world, the Turing test would remain a good measure because you wouldn't optimize to try and pass it. But since people do care, it's degraded as a measure. There are things that it's not a universal thing. Like GDP is a somewhat crude measure of the quality of an economy, but the point is that gaming GDP is not easy, because it's something you need to do collectively. You need to get a lot of people together to agree to game the system specifically, and that kind of coordination is really hard to get. So it's not universal that every single measure that you use becomes corrupted, but the Turing tests, if you sort of say that you have to, the various space achievements, you have to put a module into this orbit at this height with this amount of mass going with it. Now, there's a certain amount of stuff you can do, but if you achieve this, you still have to put a certain amount of mass in this orbit, and there's a limit to how much you can do that isn't useful, that isn't actually a rocket going up into space with stuff in it. Some of these things are harder to game than others, but my prediction and my impression is that the Turing test is more gameable than a lot of them.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
But we'll see.
We will see. Well, hopefully. I'd like to be around once the announcement is made that we certainly do have super intelligent machines.
Well, wait for it, because you're going to get a lot of announcements like that in coming years and decades. And then followed by people saying that no, this is not that, or this is that. A proper superintelligence will probably be quite clear if it arrives.
Mm-hmm.
And I also want to add an uncertainty. Mm-hmm. We focus on superintelligence because they're the most risky scenario. Again, it is not certain at all that even if we had AI that we would get this kind of superintelligence. There might be diminishing returns of various sorts. They might just unemploy everybody. But not halting problems.
You don't think?
No. The formal... The formal machine intelligence flaws are not going to be the ones that cause problems for the AI. The AIs that are successfully past this are going to have so much heuristics, so much probabilistic reasoning or stuff like that, and they need a certain amount of robustness, so they're not going to fall apart. First sort of loop or formal.
Sure. Yeah.
The halting problem means that they are. I mean, according to say the incompleteness theorem, you can never know you can't know in general what a program will do. Ever. Well, there's no general algorithm that'll tell you what all programs do. Yet we manage to program a hell of a lot of stuff to do specific stuff. Without solving the general problem. So those kind of things are of limited applicability. It's like Gödel's incompleteness that some people come up with. It points out there's a certain issue with self-reference, which there is, but as a sort of general limitation, a computer will never be able to run an economy, play chess well, or whatever, because of Gödel's income, it doesn't provide a limitation on what the AI can actually achieve in the real world in practice.
Yeah, it doesn't. It doesn't tell you what a computer cannot, what practical task a computer will never be able to do, other than, you know, solve a particular mathematical problem, for instance. But in terms of the real world, yep.
Humans have similar things to the Gödel problems there. Technically, because we can't list all ordinals, there's a limit to how far we can stand outside ourselves. Because the solution to the Gödel problem is you realize there is a problem, you meta, you go up a level. That's something you might be able to program into a computer. And it might be able to meta at several levels. And we can meta, but essentially every meta stage is connected with an ordinal. And we run out of ways of even describing the ordinal. So humans are limited in how often they can meta. So there are statements out there that there are systems out there that are our equivalents, systems that we can't lift ourselves out of.
Okay. Well, yeah. What's his name? The German guy. Yeah. Well, anyway. Well,
describe those systems, because that's part of the problem.
Jürgen Schmidhofer has the Gödel machine. Have you done much research into his algorithm? I know you know of AIXI by Marcus Hutter, of course, right?
It's kind of it's very similar to AIXI in that it could kind of work in theory with huge, huge amounts of computing power. But I suspect that the design in practice hits diminishing returns extremely fast. Faster than most self-improving systems. In that, this is just an impression, but I get the impression it's either super intelligence or stupid. There does not seem to be much sort of intermediate between them. And to be properly super intelligent, it seems to require far more resources than is realistic in any scenario.
Okay. Well,
there's a few self-reference problems or things like that, but I'm assuming that those would get solved as well.
Cool. Yeah, so then if there's anything you'd like to conclude on, or if there's a take-home message or anything that you'd like viewers to sort of digest, what would it be?
Take-home message. Well, first of all, I'm going to pitch my booklet, Smarter Than Us, that lays out the AI risks. And second of all, I'm going to, basically why such a focus on AI risk and on the scenario where it happens, it's super intelligent and dangerous. Since I said there's a lot of uncertainty, we can't be sure that this will happen, but these are also the most important ones to get right if they do happen. So I think we should focus on always, whenever we can, the largest possible problems. The Turing test is a tool, a machine that can pass the Turing test perfectly but can't do anything much is fun, but is not sort of worth worrying about in any other sense. It's the ones that are really effective and that could have a large consequence on the world that are worth worrying about. I mean, sort of mass human unemployment is a sort of minor aspect of what could go wrong. That's sort of at the bottom. So anything below that is probably not... It's not that it isn't worth worrying about, but it's less worth worrying about than the far more important problems that should get sort of tackled or put aside, shown that they can't happen before we look at the sort of lesser risks. Like, occasionally I read a very entertaining thing about how we're sort of losing our essential humanity through automation or something like that, or something of value of the human spirit that's being degraded and stuff like that. And my reaction is always, that might happen. But this is so, so low on the list of priorities or things worth worrying about, why did this person even bother writing that article? If there's a potential AI that could completely transform the world in a positive or negative impression, that's far more important. If it can unemploy everybody or practically everyone, that's still far more important. Once we've gone through that, we will have the luxury of worrying about the finer aspects of the human spirit.
I completely agree. I think there is an underfunded, under-resourced need for working on dealing with these big issues, especially superintelligence. So I'm glad that we've got some bright minds at the Future of Humanity Institute working on this. Indeed.
Thank you.
It's been lovely having you. Hope to do so again. Maybe when you have your booklet. Is it released yet?
It's on Amazon. You can get it for $3 or so,
Cool. I might get a copy.
It's free. It's on one of the licenses, which makes it free to distribute. So you could also just send emails to people who have it, and I'm sure they'll send it there.
Sure they would. Good.
And yes. And yeah. If you think it's important, then you could consider donating to the FHI, to MIRI, or any other setup that you prefer. There's not all that much. There's not all that many people worrying about it in the world, so the choice is relatively narrow. I've made progress in certain directions with certain ideas. I should not be able to be having progress in so many different directions on the existential risk front. It should be that I should only be able to add a very narrow refinement to a very well-established field. Except, of course, since there's so few people doing this, there isn't a well-established field.
That makes sense. So I'll provide
But
links to those to the book and a donation link to FHI in the
the
description.
nicest, oh, thank you. The nicest thing that someone could convince me of is that I've wasted my entire life. That actually these risks are, they're either I was wrong about them, or that actually they found ways of controlling it, so it's all fine. So if I could become unemployed in that way, that would be the best outcome for humanity.
Yes, well, I'm hoping that it's the latter, that you get unemployed because the problems are solved.
Thank you.
And I mean that in the nicest of ways possible.
Yes, I understand.
Well, it's been lovely having you on the show, Stuart. I look forward to another one in the future, perhaps focusing on the AI risk. All right, well, cheers. Signing out.